All right, Shalom. Yeah, I tried to go live and just wasn't cooperating even after I switched it to the Wi-Fi. So yeah, I'm gonna just go ahead and upload this out on Ratazah when I get back to the tent. And I got pretty solid Wi-Fi. Yeah, I'm at the Melbourne Museum. This is the biggest museum in the city. As I was explaining, I was actually on the way to a museum that concentrates on the Aboriginal folks. But then I saw this one, so I said, "Oh, let me just go ahead and hop off," because I wasn't sure where this one actually was, and I just happened to by chance see it when I was on the way to the train station. So. Yeah, and, you know, Australia is known for all types of poisonous creatures. Right, as it says here, Australia is famous for having many of the world's most venomous animals. Yep. Yeah, you got the Tasmanian devil, which that's on the island of Tasmania, which is still technically a part of Australia. You got all these different spiders. And this is how the Heavenly Father can take your ass out, you know? As it says in the book of Surah, the 39th chapter, there be spirits that are created for vengeance. So the Heavenly Father got a lot of vengeful spirits out here. As a matter of fact, when I was in Bali, you know, something bit me. And I didn't know what the hell it was, and I actually felt it. Like, I never felt like affected like that, being stung by something. I didn't know if it was a snake or I didn't know what the hell was going on. But ultimately, I was good. Yeah, the pain subsided after a while. But yeah, man, it was.
Alerting to you that this happens in about 10 minutes of time at 1:45 p.m. We will be presenting giving out meals in the Malari Garden.
Yeah, it was some trippy shit. So like I was saying on the live, I'm only gonna try to be in here for about no more than 50 minutes. So just like always, you know, you brothers and sisters, you can go ahead and pause to like check out more on your own time. I still wanna hit up that Indigenous Museum, and I still wanna get out on the highways and hedges, at least for a little bit. Yeah, before it starts getting, you know, real, real cold and getting dark. Yeah, because once you get outside of the mostly like eastern cities, yeah, you see all of this stuff. You see all this type of stuff. Because most people live like on the East Coast, so you go up to like Queensland. That's where the brother's at. The brother that brings it out in Brisbane. Then you go to New South Wales, which is where I was in Sydney. That's the state. Then you go here to Victoria. And I think there's one more city that's like south of here. Yeah, that's pretty much it, with the exception of Perth, which is in Western Australia. And then you got Canberra, which that's the capital. And that's the only city that's like a big city that's kind of inland, you know? Everywhere else, man, people are just on the coast because, and then you got these things. You got these things that'll pop up on you. Might have a fucking kangaroo pop up at your house. So yeah, let me just go ahead and keep running through. Thank you. is made out of whale teeth. These necklaces. That's something different. Warrior stuff right here, the aggression instrument. And so I had a friend that went to New Zealand back in like 2007, 2008. And she brought me something back. Not quite like that, but it was like a traditional little weapon. It's like wooden. Whale oil, it's crazy. Yeah, there's a lot up in here. There's a lot up in here, so. The first peoples. AKA Aboriginals. Go ahead and check this out. Okay, yeah, here it is. Then they got some more upstairs. Oh, dope. Again, you see, Esau, he's saying, hey, look, man, we acknowledge that you're the custodians of this land. And one guy was telling me, this Uber driver was telling me that they pretty much can bring a suit and get like parts of the land back. Talking about the Aboriginal people. This is just some of their get-ups. Peoples.
This is right. Through their cloak.
No designs describing what you've been through, and when you pass on, you're buried with that possum skin cloak, with the designs sort of facing, so your story can be covered after death.
The fibers are hollow in the possum fur, so they keep you warmer and drier, and they don't freeze. So that is the significant difference why possum and cloaks is so significant.
Oh, wow.
Doesn't mean you didn't have a kangaroo skin.
Yeah, me getting a possum,
it's
crazy.
Another wall of skin,
so
I think that's the difference in the significance of the
cloak. The skin side would keep you cool during the summer, and the fur side would keep you warm in the winter. So these possum skin cloaks were made with different skins of possums, all stitched together.
Obviously, they went out and hunted the possum. They track him back to the trees after being manned down too.
Capturing possums, put your land here, smoking them out. The holes.
Traditionally, we use kangaroo sinew as the thread.
So the tendon off the back of the hind leg of the kangaroo.
Skinning them, then they had to be stretched and scraped. I believe our women had a bag made of possum fur with all the wooden nails that you would peg out the skin.
And stitched with either a bone or a kangaroo leg or the echidna quills.
And they'd rub kangaroo fat on them and ochre, and that was staying different parts of the cloak for different meanings.
Once you got it all together, use a piece of flint or something to cut in some designs.
If you think about how many skins are in possum cloaks, 50 plus, then that's a lot of possums, so they're very, very special and significant and of high value in our pre-European economy, and even at contact period, it would cost you 2 stone axes to acquire a possum cloak.
Some designs are burnt onto the cloak or etched in, and then covered with ochre as well.
Usually, like the red ochre that's found on the cloak that come from here is usually found up along the line, or one of the men come from up in the line as well.
So what was the red ochre design?
One of the designs that come with that same type of real design.
Oh, wow. If his laws are broken, he destroys. Bonjour sent the ancestor spirits to create the world. Wow, heavy. Right, because you know that Yahweh sent Yahushua and angels, to, which are really the remnant, the elect, you know, to create the world. Excuse me, sir. lawman. You know what I'm thinking? Looking at this.
Seals, they were clubbed to death because they never had threats. So the sealers exploited the women's skills. They're in connection with the seals, so they understood the behavior. I think about Louisa Briggs, my great grandmother, witnessing this time of change. The violence, the smells of death being a part of the hunting creatures that we share. This was the early impact of colonization to clothe, to create the oil for the emerging middle class and youth that built their economics in our country. Our women are alone. They're not safe anymore. They also took the most valuable assets. Our women as their concubines. They changed our families' lives by removing the women, the brothers, the babas, the children. This was the time of chaos. And in that change began another journey for Louisa. As a young child, she was exported on a ship traveling across that Bass Strait. They took part of my life. They took my family member, my great-grandmother, her aunties. They were taken, they were removed from this place. We created a new generation of us. I realize I'm a product of those sealers. I carry their name. And I'm very honored to be able to give voice to her memory. This is a story about resilience and adaption and coming home. My great-grandmother Louisa Briggs returned after being kidnapped by the sealers. It was through her memories that we know these stories, and I will continue to give her voice. So once again, Mwamajika Mwamiki, Mwamiki,
will you, 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 And that's where they were caught up and dealt with by the stockmen. My father talked about this being a place where the Aborigines had been massacred and killed. Something very violent did happen here. And it basically decimated the population here. It was a very well-kept secret. The isolation of the area is what's helped that too. Anything that was violent is very hard to talk about. These difficult histories, it's something that we have to admit to. You know, these hard histories did happen. It's people killing people. And we as European settlers have got to accept that fact.
You can see the visual beauty of this area. But when you start looking into it, you can see the pain, how this area has been stained and hurt for a long time. A lot of people know about it, a lot of non-Indigenous people don't know about it, or they don't want to know about it. All the sites that are named throughout Gippsland are all known because they are recorded. Then there are sites that a lot of people know about, especially the Black Forest. All the people, they talk about it all the time. When we go to places, always said don't go there and not hear parties that you're speaking about here. That's where the White Forest shot and killed the White Forest. So in Aboriginal oral history, we know that happened. Our people pass it down. They need to be acknowledged as well. I believe researchers before our people go out of history, people don't believe it until it's written down. You look at the names, Skull Creek, Richards Ridge, Butcher's Creek, not named after a butcher. Most times it's named after what happened there. A lot of people live there, they never knew what it was. I wanted to learn about the past history, the bad past. And the people that did this sort of stuff, it's actually amazing. McMillan and his entourage. You know, you go to Spreadsburg to McMillan Street, you go to McMillan Street, McMillan Hotel. His name is very common. At each spot, you'll see the moment where Angus McMillan went, at each spot, I can guarantee within a kilometre or less, there was always a massacre in that area. In Gippsland, we have no monuments of what happened to our people. It's just a part of our community. Just a simple power of knowledge. When does the hurt stop? When do people start acknowledging? Children and people today are so wanting to learn the truth. We're all hearing from the truth. The more we acknowledge that happens, the better off the struggle.
As you can see, this is a beautiful piece of land here, and I understand why the Beveridge family chose to squat here, but they didn't negotiate with the traditional owners of this land to be here. It was rule number one broken. Andrew Beveridge, he was the son of the early settlers that came in and claimed this land, and they come out here and they built homes and stuff. They took a big lot of land. Some Aboriginal people were employed, and the other Aboriginal people were dismissed. They were moved off the land permanently. And a lot of settlers come out, squatters come out, and they had no regard for Aboriginal law. They just took whatever the next attack. what they needed, what they wanted to take. Andrew Beveridge, he took that woman and wouldn't give her back. Anyways, he got speared just while he's laying over there in the grave. And then the girl went back to her family. Then after that, they pretty much killed most of the Aboriginal fellas in. 100 of them shot him. But Andrew Beveridge should have done the right thing. You know, traded cattle off for that woman or let the woman go. I think we're at an age now where both these histories can be talked about honestly and openly without any anger or malice. You can't carry that because it'll ruin your life.
Thank you. Baba, don't we all? Like I did.
Survival day. and also our statewide and national. These songs on the surface are iconic songs. They are promises of meaning.
I'm going to go to the next one.